Well, welcome to the 700 Club. For today's headlines, let's go over to the CBN News Desk.
Thanks, Gordon. President Obama's new general is now on the ground in Afghanistan, but there are still plenty of doubts for the war. And as John Jessup reports, some of those doubts are causing a fallout within the GOP.
General David Petraeus now assumes command.
At his change of command ceremony, Petraeus warned that this is a tough fight and that it may get more intense before it gets better. But he also demonstrated resolve, saying we are in it to win.
We must demonstrate to the people and to the Taliban that Afghan and ISAF forces are here to safeguard the Afghan people and that we are in this to win. That is our clear objective.
His focus will be fighting Al-Qaeda and the Taliban and protecting the Afghan people so that the Afghan government can stand on its own.
Washington, from the administration to Capitol Hill, is putting its hope in General Petraeus, thinking he can replicate his success in improving security there, just like he did in Iraq back in 2007. And some are already giving him leeway.
I said to General Petraeus today, don't hesitate, please, to make the case to the Commander-in-Chief, to Congress, if you feel it's justified, that you actually need more troops. More American troops here in the short run so that we can win here and not stretch this out over the long run.
But not everyone is as optimistic. Republican Chairman Michael Steele is trying to keep his job after comments cut on YouTube saying this is Obama's war, calling it unwinnable.
For a chairman of the party to articulate that point of view, to advance that point of view, is indefensible.
Mr. Steele is going to have to assess as to whether he can still lead the Republican Party.
John Jessup, CBN News, Washington.
July 4th was a special day for many people to celebrate freedom as new U.S. citizens. In Massachusetts, 27 new U.S. citizens from 20 different countries took their oath on board the USS Constitution, the nation's oldest commissioned warship. About 3,800 people across the country became U.S. citizens on Independence Day. 300 members of the armed forces took their oath in San Diego. And on the front lines of freedom in Iraq, this group of U.S. soldiers became citizens of the country they've already been serving. The oil spill is keeping tourists away from parts of the Gulf this holiday weekend, and that's ruining what is normally the busiest season for many business owners. The U.S. Coast Guard is trying to clean up the oil spill, but business owners say it's too late for this holiday. A large skimmer has been put in place. It's supposed to take in 20 million gallons of oil a day. The tanker could be siphoning the oil as early as next week. Spain's new abortion law takes effect today. It allows unrestricted abortions in the first 14 weeks of pregnancy. Hundreds of protesters rallied outside the capital in Madrid to challenge the law. It allows girls as young as 16 to have abortions without parental consent. The conservative Popular Party has filed an appeal arguing the new law is unconstitutional. Well, those are today's top stories. Gordon and Terry will be right back with more of the 700 Club.
Still ahead,
it's not my home.
Country music legend Ronnie Millsap.
Oh, one day I'm gonna fly.
And the chance meeting that made him a star.
He said, well, son, you can be a lawyer if you want to, but there's a lot of music in your heart.
Later on today's 700 Club.
Oh, yes, I will.
Finding something you need at a discounted price is exciting, right? Well, today I've got great news. The best investments of the 21st century, gold and silver, both are great values right now. That's right. This is a major buying opportunity in the strongest bull market in decades. And now's the time to take action. Here's why. Following major gold dips, prices historically rise an average of 36%. So, if this pattern continues, gold may soon rise to $1,400 an ounce. You better seize this golden opportunity today. Protect and grow your assets with gold from the only company I trust, Swiss America. Education is the first step. Call or visit online today for the Pat Boone 2010 Rare Opportunity Kit. Now's the time to own the best investments of the century from the best company in the country at the best prices of the year. Call now.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
Shirley Springsteen started out as a single mother, only making minimum wage. But soon she went from being a cashier to owning her own business. And here's how she did it.
Merle Springsteen of Rawlins, Wyoming, has achieved more in a few short years than many people do in a lifetime. But when Merle first moved to Wyoming as a single mother, the future didn't look so bright.
It's hard at first, but I have to do what I have to do to support my kids. And that's what I did. So I got a job as a cashier, making minimum wage. I think that time is only $5.25 an hour.
Even though her income was small, Merle tithed faithfully.
I was taught when I was a child to give 10% to God. And that's it. I've been practicing it ever since I was a kid.
Merle worked her way up to accounting manager and bought a house for her family. A year later, she refinanced and bought a larger home better suited for her kids' needs. Their first home became a rental. Through it all, she didn't waver in her giving.
As my income grows or increases, you know, of course, my giving is increasing too.
Over the next 8 years, Merle bought more residential and commercial properties.
The Lord keep on increasing, you know? Some people even come to me, can you buy my property? Yeah, and it's a good buy.
In 2005, Merle decided to become a CBN partner at the basic level, giving $20 a month.
One night, when I turned it on, it's 700 Club, and they, you know, when you give $20, I like to give. You know how the Lord talk to you? There's a small voice, okay, give. So I give 20 first, then the next month, I want to increase it, because 20 is just little to me, you know?
Merle increased her giving to $40 a month. As her rental business grew, she continued to increase her pledge. Just 2 years after becoming a CBN partner, Merle became a member of the Chairman's Circle, giving $10,000 a year.
I know God give us the power to get wealth. So I know God is on my side. And whatever I do, I always prosper. I think that's the power of giving.
Merle now manages 60 rental properties and 3 businesses. She says her success is no accident.
I know for sure it's Him. It's God who give me the ability, you know? Sometimes He give you the simple idea what to do. I write the tithe first, I give it first, He supply all my needs. I think I find favor with God.
I think I find favor with God. How can you be sure that you'll find favor with them? It's all because of what Jesus has done for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We have favor. We have favor. Now, in that favor, do we walk according to what He tells us to do? And if we do, then He'll tell us even more. It's incredible what He'll do for us if we'll only obey. He wants to bless His children. He wants to. But on our part, it takes us saying, okay, I trust You, Daddy. I trust Your word. I trust that You want to bless me. And here's what I'll do. Here's it is from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 17. Never think that it was your own strength and energy that made you wealthy. Always remember that it is the Lord your God who gives you the power to become rich. Now look at Merle's story. Here she is, a single mom, struggling. She's got to feed her kids, so she goes out and gets a minimum wage job. And if there was one person on the planet, you say, well, you know, does God need Merle's money? No, He doesn't. Doesn't need yours either. But what you need, what Merle needed, was to establish for yourself that you're putting God first. And so Merle did that. And even though it was a minimum wage job, she gave. And God honored that and started giving Merle ideas for new businesses, new opportunities. And over time, it multiplied and multiplied and multiplied. That can happen to you. All it takes on your part is to not to forget God, to say, okay, I'm going to put Him first. Here are the first fruits. Here are my tithes and offerings. And realize one of the great principles of the kingdom of heaven, your 90% is much greater than 100%. That when you tithe, you are saying to God, to yourself, I trust God to do miracles with the 90. I'll know what He'll do with the 10, but I'm going to trust Him to do miracles with the 90. and give an increase, so much so that I cannot contain it. That can happen to you. So today, just resolve that you're going to be faithful. You're going to give. And then when God gives you ideas, this is the other part of it, trust them. Trust the source. Act on them and see the blessings come to you. What He's done for others, He will do for you. Terry?
Well, in one part of India, more than 300 people die every month from malaria. Not long ago, entire families were in danger of being wiped out until a medical team from Operation Blessing arrived in their village. Watch.
The Araku Valley lies in the eastern mountains of India. The landscape is beautiful, but inside the valley are hundreds of people who are quickly dying. Dasu, Bodri, and their three children were among them. Their entire family was infected with cerebral malaria, a fatal disease that's carried by mosquitoes. Dasu and Bodri had few options. Until recently, there were no roads into their village, so they were cut off from the rest of the world.
The only person we could go to for help was a witch doctor, but we refused to go to him because we believed in Jesus. We prayed with our pastor and believed God for a miracle.
That miracle came when a new road made it possible for vehicles to reach their village for the very first time. Operation Blessing came in and conducted a medical camp.
I heard about the medical camp and walked all the way through a dense forest with my kids. After we were diagnosed with cerebral malaria, the doctors wanted to go to our home and test my husband as well. So we rode back in the medical bus.
Dasu also tested positive for malaria. Each member of the family got a 3-day course of medicine that saved their lives.
This is the first time doctors from outside have come to our village and our home. You came and found out about us and then gave us medical treatment for free. I have never seen this act of kindness in my life.
On this medical mission, the team treated over 500 people with cerebral malaria. They also gave out mosquito nets and taught families how to prevent further outbreaks.
I was afraid because we see people dying all the time. But by God's grace, you gave us a blood test and medicines right away. I'm really happy that you came to help us.
Our family could have died if you have not come here and treated us. We are grateful and thankful for your help.
Hard to imagine, isn't it? People living so remotely that nobody gets through to their village. And yet, Operation Blessing pulls into town, into village, and does a medical clinic there, saving the lives of not just Dasu and Bodri, but families like them, 500 and some people, all with the same dilemma. We're doing that around the world in many, many different places, and the only way it's able to happen is when you care enough to make it happen. So we ask you today to go to your phone and join the 700 Club. It's 65 cents a day, $20 a month, but when you do that, you allow us to reach out with love and compassion in the name of Jesus to people all around the world. So thank you for going to your phone now. Our number's toll-free. It's 1-800-759-0700. You can also log on to cbn.com. And do it that way. When you give, will you consider giving through what we call Pledge Express? It's electronic monthly giving, means your bank does all the work, saves you all the hassle, but it also saves us some administrative costs that allow us to put even more of your gift directly into the lives of people like this little family you just saw. So please call now. When you give through Pledge Express, our way of saying thank you is to send you Power for Life teachings each month. We believe that this will bless you in your own walk with the Lord, and we want to thank you for helping us touch families like this. We're going to be back after this, so stay with us.
Up next, she preferred married men.
You could have a relationship and they'd have to go home.
Except her own husband.
No one was going to tell me what to do.
How one fight nearly took her life.
I tried to put my foot in the trigger. I had both barrels in my mouth.
And how another one saved it.
While Mary feeds her two young daughters, she also helps feed needy families around the world. While Bob hands a drink out to a coworker, he helps give water to villages with new wells. And while Carl builds a house for his son's new puppy, he helps rebuild homes in disaster areas.
These people all have something in common. They're CBN partners who have joined Pledge Express. I hope you'll consider joining Pledge Express too. It's a way to simplify your own life while speeding help to others, all at the same time. There are no checks to remember or stamps to buy, and your gift goes to work faster, helping those who need it most. So join us and change the world for someone today.
Hi, I'm Dr. Joyce Brothers. Those of us who are independent and live alone shouldn't do so without having emergency protection. And for reliability and peace of mind, I recommend Alert USA.
With Alert USA, if you ever need assistance, just press your pendant to be connected to an operator who can summon help to your home 24 hours a day.
I've been giving advice for many years, and I believe Alert USA provides the best emergency support and value for your dollar. Call now for a free brochure.
Alcohol nearly killed Karen Riegel. One night as she fumbled for the trigger of her shotgun, nearly killed her daughter, too.
I was not a good person. Married men were awesome. You could have a relationship, nobody told you what to do, and they'd have to go home. There wasn't anything that I hadn't done. If you hit the Ten Commandments, I did them all, every one of them, including murder, really murder. When you have two abortions, which I did.
At the time, Karen Riegel didn't even think about it. The only thing on her mind was her next drink.
Every time I drank, it was to drink and get drunk, not just to drink, you know, have a cocktail. Literally, I was blacking out by the time I was 18. There wasn't anything about myself that I liked.
There was just a lot of anger. It started brewing when Karen was a child.
There was a babysitter who did really horrible things to me. There was an uncle that did things that were wrong. My father left when I was 5 years old. I literally followed him out the door, got on my three-wheeled bike, and followed him down the road. He had to pick me up and bring me back and put me in the house. And he told me that night, I'll be here to pick you up tomorrow, because I was a daddy's girl. I didn't really get along with my mother. And the next day, he didn't come and get me.
It was 3 years before she finally got to go live with her dad. But even that had its challenges. Now Karen had to compete with her stepmom for her father's attention.
I think I took all those things and said, I'll do what I want when I want. And I wanted to be bad. I wanted to hurt people the way that I'd been hurt. And what I didn't understand is I was hurting myself.
There were lots of suicide attempts.
I had my stomach pumped. At 16, slipped my wrist at 18. It was torment to be on this earth.
Karen thought getting married and having a baby was the answer, but it just made things more difficult. Alcohol destroyed her first marriage. Her addiction got so bad that Karen even neglected her baby girl.
Once in a while, if it was early enough, I'd call the girl across the street or the girl next door and say, look, Caitlin's sleeping. I'm gonna be right down the road. They knew where I was gonna be.
Then Karen married Ronnie. Things started to fall apart when he asked her to stop drinking.
I wanted him out of my life because no one was going to tell me what to do or ask me or care or anything else.
One night after a big argument, Karen almost blew her head off with her husband's shotgun.
I tried to put my foot in the trigger of the gun. I had both barrels in my mouth and I was holding, I was trying. I was just too drunk to do it. So I'm like, okay, I'll just go to sleep and give me a few minutes and then...
And then Ronnie found her, passed out with his gun pointing directly at their daughter's bedroom. It was a close call that night, not just for Karen, but for her little girl.
Then 9/11 happened and my husband felt very called to go to church. He was like, you're going to church. I'm like, I'm not going to church. He's like, you're going to church. I'm like, no, I'm not.
Ronnie won and Karen went to church, but very reluctantly. Then, after a few Sundays,
I went and I sat down in the pew, and I was like, okay, I'm going to go out and be a pew warmer, you know. So the music starts, and I'm just like, la, 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 la. And it was all of it, but as soon as, like, I can't, it's the shout to the Lord, and I got real quiet. All I heard that day was, Karen, come to me. I don't know what even possessed me, but I got up, then I went to the altar, and I got on my knees. It was the first time in my life that I said, I can't do this. I don't know how to do this. I only know this life. I don't know a life without drinking. I don't know a life without everything that I'm going through. And I, again, come to me, and I will love you. And I said, okay, I love you. The day that I accepted Jesus Christ, I went home and I sat on my porch and I had maybe three or four beers, you know, but I didn't get drunk that night. But it was just like I kept saying, I've got to let this go.
With the help of God and some people at her church, Karen was able to give up alcohol altogether.
I haven't touched it, and it's been 5 years. Now my favorite thing is to sit on my porch, talk to my hummingbirds, read my Bible, and drink coffee. The hope and the peace that lives and dwells in me now, I can't even describe it. It just is there and it takes over. I mean, I wake up in the morning, it's thank you, Jesus, for the life that I have, what you've given me. I have had things that I have never had in my life. I have a home, I have a husband who adores me, I have children who love their mother. Most of all, I have love in my heart, which I never had. There's a box out there, and every sin that I've ever committed, I could pull out, pick one out, and his name is written on it and says, forgiven. He took dirt from the road and made a vessel. Every chain that ever held me is gone. The only chain that there is now is really not a chain, it's a yoke. And I am yoked with Jesus Christ. My man is right here.
My man is right here. And that can happen to you. And some of us, we think we've gone too far. We've committed so many bad sins that we think God doesn't want anything to do with me. I can't go to church. If you make me go to church, I'll just sit there. But that story was for you. Maybe you've lived part of Karen's story. Maybe you've done the things that she did. Maybe you got hurt real bad when you were young. And you felt abandoned, you felt unloved, you felt rejected. Let him come to you. Ask him to come. You know? And then you find out, just like Karen, he's asking you. And he's saying to you right now, come to me. Come to me. Come to me. You can come home to him. He'll receive you. You don't have to get cleaned up first. You don't have to do anything. But just show up and say, okay, Lord, I come. Here's the promise from Jesus. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hear my voice, that's you, anyone, and open the door, I'll come in. All you have to do is open the door. All you have to do is make that first step. All you have to do is ask. And when you do, he'll come in. What he's done for others, he'll do it for you. What he did for Karen, she said he took dirt from the ground and made it into a vessel. He can take you. He can use you. He can cleanse you. He can make all things new for you. And all the things, all the chains, all the mistakes, he can break them all. He can make them all right. For you, he can do the same thing. He can write forgiven on all of it, all of it. So if this is for you, this is what you want, bow your head, pray a very simple prayer, and let Jesus come to you today. Lord Jesus, that's right, say it out loud. Lord Jesus, I come to you today And Jesus, I ask that you would come into my heart, that you would make me new again, that you would forgive me, cleanse me, and set me on a path to be with you. And Jesus, if you'll do this, I promise to follow you all the days of my life. Hear my prayer. Forgive me. Be with me. For I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, for those who just prayed, I pray a baptism in your love. I ask that your forgiveness would just flow through them, that they would be made new today from their innermost being, made new. For we ask it now in Jesus' name. Amen. If you just prayed with me, the Bible says that if you'll believe in your heart, confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. What I want you to do is confess and say, yeah, I just asked Jesus into my heart. I just want to let the world know, let someone else know that I just made him Lord of my life. Number's toll free, 1-800-759-0700. We've got a free packet for you, and all of it's free. It's called A New Day, and there's a CD teaching how to live the Christian life. We encourage you to get a copy of the Bible and do what Karen does every day. She goes out and talks to the hummingbirds, reads her Bible, and has a great time. Read your Bible every day. It's through that you get the renewing of your mind. You get transformed. We also encourage you to join a local church. It's through the fellowship of other believers that you grow in Christ. But it starts with that phone call. Make it right now. 1-800-759-0700. Terry, over to you.
Well, up next, how Ronnie Millsap discovered his hidden talent.
I could play by ear. I could hear a song on the radio a couple of times, and I could memorize the melody and the lyrics and sing it for you.
The sights and sounds of a country music legend, plus gambling, alcohol, and more country music. The story behind a national landmark and how it saved a city after this. And with us today, Emmy Award-winning narrator Stephen Johnston with his brand new DVD Bible.
That's right. And brand new technology has put the entire King James Bible on just one DVD. Instead of $29.95 for two discs, we're passing the savings on to you, and all you'll pay is just $19.95. Easy to see large text is displayed on your TV while I read every word to you.
And whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Well, this would be great for someone like my mother who's beginning to lose her vision.
It's easy. With the touch of your remote, you can go to chapter and book.
Chapter 4.
I understand there's a bonus section.
That's right. There's a tour of the Holy Land gallery of photos with all its rich history.
Well, I've never seen anything like this.
We sold over a million of the two-disc DVD Bibles for just $29.95. But this new single DVD Bible with the Holy Land photo tour is yours for just $19.95. You save $10.
When you order now, you get the Children's Bible Favorites, a $9.95 value, free.
David knew he could stop Goliath with his slingshot.
The DVD Bible makes a great gift.
You're right. And because the DVD Bible makes such a perfect gift, when you call in the next 20 minutes, we'll send you a second DVD Bible to share with a loved one absolutely free. You get two complete DVD Bibles, a $40 value, for just $19.95.
Order your DVD Bible right now.
And God bless you. I know this will change your life.
To order your complete King James Version of the Bible on one DVD with both the Old and New Testament, and get a second King James Bible free, both with your two free children's bonus CDs, all for only $19.95 plus processing, call 1-800-925-4334. That's 1-800-925-4334. Or go to BiblesOnDVD.com. It makes a great gift for friends, family, Bible study, Sunday school, or church groups. Order now.
We'll be right back. And welcome back to the 700 Club. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton arrived in Georgia today, telling the country the U.S. is ready to help achieve peace. The Russian military invaded Georgia 2 years ago, looking to regain its influence in the region. Clinton encouraged Georgia to concentrate on economic development and democracy building, and said Georgia should avoid being baited or provoked by Russia. CBN World Reach launches a new season of its popular global program, Turning Point International, this week. For the first time since it debuted in 1997, the program will have a new host. He is Nigerian-born Muyiwa Olarewaju. He is a well-known worship leader, singer, and award-winning Christian radio host in the United Kingdom. Turning Point will feature personal testimonies. The weekly program will be broadcast in 15 countries in Africa, as well as the Caribbean and Europe. You can find more information about this program and others at cbn.com/worldreach. Gordon and Terry will be right back with more of the 700 Club.
If you're looking at a home security system, or even if you already have one, ADT can give you so much more. Like our new keychain remote. Now you can easily arm and disarm your system with the touch of a button, even turn on your lights. You can also count on fast alarm response from our advanced network of monitoring centers. Plus, great local service, ADT's exclusive theft protection guarantee, and a money-back guarantee if you're not completely satisfied. And you can get all this and more for as little as a dollar a day. A single ADT system can help protect your home from burglary, fire, and carbon monoxide. When an alarm is received, ADT can respond quickly, calling the local authorities for help. You can even add new technology like SafeWatch Video View. Now you can know what's happening in your home by actually seeing it on your cell phone, computer, or TV. Even if you already have a security system, it's easy to add ADT monitoring. Call now and save over $250 when you buy ADT's family package.
It's peace of mind that can also save your life.
ADT, always there.
Ronnie Millsap was born to make music, and he did. Over the years, he sold 35 million records, released 40 number one hits, and won 7 Grammy Awards. But as Ronnie told Scott Ross, he almost missed his calling.
Yeah!
Most people know Ronnie Millsap for the songs that made him a star. Songs like What a Difference You Made in My Life and Any Day Now. He's made his mark in country, soul, and pop music.
Oh, one day I'm gonna fly way over to the other side. I know I'll get to see the Lord.
Ronnie has always wanted to return to the music that shaped his life, gospel music, the music he loved singing in church, that connected him to God. But the hits got in the way until now.
Think maybe you've done it right?
The formula works pretty well. It works pretty well. During the process of all that, Scott, I never got to make a gospel album. Never. You know, Scott, so many of these songs, I've known them ever since I was a child.
Now, I was gonna bring that up and ask you that. For you, is it more than just the gospel songs? Is there some spiritual meaning for you behind that? Is there a relationship with God, with Christ, that's part of your life? Or are you just a church guy making a gospel song?
I am a Christian. I am a Christian, knowing that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Was there a moment in time that happened for you? Was it something that evolved?
It was something that happened to me when I was 12 years old.
Really?
Yes.
In that little church in North Carolina?
Yes.
And the encounter was, you heard the preacher and...
I heard the preacher and I knew that I was saved.
Ronnie grew up in the Smoky Mountains of Western North Carolina. He was born with congenital glaucoma. His parents believed his blindness was a curse from God. They took him from one church revival to the next, hoping God would bring sight to their son. His parents divorced, so his grandparents took him in and raised him. At the age of 6, he was sent to Raleigh to attend the State School for the Blind. It was there he discovered his musical talents.
How do you do that, not being able to see, you know, to find the frets and the strings, or sit at a keyboard even, and learn how to do that. I mean, that's a God-given gift.
It is. It is. And I learned when I started studying piano, I could play by ear. I could hear a song on the radio a couple of times, and I could memorize the melody and the lyrics and sing it for you after a couple of plays. See?
Ronnie was a standout in school, making the honor roll all the way through. He was also a musical prodigy, excelling on the piano and violin. He hoped to pursue a career in music, but well-meaning school officials frowned on the idea.
My counselor said, no, we can't do that, because if you become a musician, you're going to wind up out on the street, you'll be a failure, and more than that, you'll be a liability to the state. I said, okay, I'll take this academic career you guys are wanting me to do, and I'll become a lawyer. How about that? A lawyer. I'll do that.
One night at a concert, Ronnie got the rare privilege to go backstage and meet the legendary Ray Charles. Ronnie asked Ray for advice.
And there was a piano in the dressing room, and he said, well, play me something. So I went over and played him three songs, and he said, well, son, you can be a lawyer if you want to, but there's a lot of music in your heart. If I were you, I'd follow what my heart tells me to do.
Ronnie took that advice and never looked back.
I'm a Christian man that lives it every day, and believing that somebody will look and live by example.
Right. Well, that's the best way, isn't it?
You know, I think so.
What does a person who has never seen, a blind person, see? What do you see? I mean, you've never seen a guitar. You can feel it. You don't see a keyboard, but you certainly know your way around a keyboard.
Yeah.
You've never seen your wife.
Right. On the screen of my mind, it's usually depending on who you're with. When I'm with my wife, I know she's a beautiful woman. I know that. And more than that is what she is inside. Mm-hmm. She's beautiful inside. She loves music just like I do. And probably that's the main thing that brought us together. And not only that, Scott, it's probably the thing that keeps us together.
Ronnie and Joyce have been married for 43 years. They have one grown son and three grandchildren. So with the support of family, friends, and his fans, Ronnie realized his lifelong dream, recording his first gospel album, Then Sings My Soul.
You're a blessed man.
Yes, absolutely. And I thank God for the blessings in my life.
Well, unless something miraculous happens between now and then, there's a great little verse in scriptures that said, we would see Jesus.
Yes.
So that day will come for you.
I know that. I know that. And I think I'm going to be there.
I believe it.
And I don't see here on this side, but I will see on the other side.
I know I'll get to see. I get to walk them golden streets. And I get to see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And I get to see the Lord. Oh, yes, I will.
There's a lot of music in him. And some of it is put on this wonderful new release. It's 24 favorite hymns and gospel songs, and it's called, appropriately, Then Sings My Soul. Available around the country.
What a wonderful story. What a wonderful man. Yeah. Ronnie, you'll see him. Yeah. Well, Sam Jones was a rowdy drunk. Tom Ryman was a freewheeling riverboat tycoon. The two were an unlikely duo to be part of building a church, especially one that's become a national icon.
It's called the Mother Church of Country Music, the Ryman Auditorium in Nashville. Hundreds of country music stars and even a few rock and rollers have performed here. The Ryman has hosted presidents, operas, and marriages, but it's best known as being the former home of the Grand Ole Opry. And it all started with a steamboat tycoon named Tom Ryman and an evangelist named Sam Jones. After the Civil War, the railroad industry in the South took many years to rebuild, but the waterways flowed smooth and steady. Entrepreneurs like Tom Ryman started steamboat businesses along the Mississippi and Cumberland Rivers. But along with the cargo, Ryman ships often carried casinos, barrooms, and dancing girls. But Tom Ryman's life changed the night he met Sam Jones. Sam Jones was born and raised in Cartersville, Georgia. A promising career as a lawyer was derailed when the bottle got the best of him. Jones would go on drunken binges for days at a time, neglecting his family and business. He was thrown out of bars for his drunken uproars and for failing to pay his tab. Then one day, Jones caught a glance of himself in a saloon mirror. He didn't like what he saw.
I saw my hair matted, the filth and vomit on my clothes, one of my eyes totally closed and my lips swollen. And I said, is that all that is left of the proud and brilliant young lawyer, Sam Jones?
Sam then remembered a promise he had made to his dying father.
Sam's father said, you've brought so much heartache to my heart. Can I trust you? Will you promise me, Sam, that you'll meet me in heaven?
Sam dropped to his knees and cried out to God so loudly, the bartender thought he was having a heart attack. A miserable drunk fell to the floor that night, but the person who stood up was a new man. He dried out for 3 days, took a bath, shaved, bought a new suit, and went home to his wife.
She didn't even recognize her own husband. I said, honey, God has given you a new husband and the children a new daddy. And I wonder if you will ever forgive me and start all over again.
Sam took up the ministry and began preaching in tent revivals all around the country. Over the next 20 years, he reached several million people and converted over 500,000. His plain and simple preaching style was effective in reaching the common man.
He just didn't have time for being dignified. He was just raw, he was real, he was pure, he was honest to a fault. I've read a lot of his sermons and I've read, you know, a lot of his anecdotes, and he was very funny in the pulpit.
Sam's unique combination of homespun humor and fire and brimstone drew thousands of people to his tent revivals. Jones once told a congregation in Toledo, if the devil were mayor of this town, he wouldn't change a thing. In May 1885, Jones held a tent revival on this spot in Nashville, and 10,000 people showed up. Legend has it that Captain Tom Ryman showed up as well with his rowdy friends to heckle the evangelist.
It's an interesting story, and it makes people remember him, but that's not actually what happened. At the time that Sam Jones came to town, Tom Ryman was married, and he and his children, ranging from age 14 to about 3, went to the meeting.
Sam Jones preached his heart out that night, and when the invitation was given, steamboat captain Tom Ryman was one of the first to respond.
You know, Tom Ryman had a real love for his mother. Sam spoke on, you know, on mothers, and it just cut Tom to the core.
After the revival, Ryman gave the down payment for a tabernacle in Nashville.
Tom Ryman told Sam Jones that when they built the auditorium, he would never have to preach in the tent again when he came to Nashville.
3 years later, the money was raised to begin construction on the Union Gospel Tabernacle. After he accepted Christ, Ryman no longer sold liquor or allowed gambling on his boats. But even without the revenue from these sources, Ryman became the most successful shipping magnate in the South. He built a mansion on nearby Rutledge Hill, where he could watch his ships sail up and down the Cumberland River. Sam Jones and Tom Ryman became good friends over the next decade. When Ryman passed away in 1904, the man who gave the eulogy was none other than Sam Jones. There, he called for a vote to change the name of the Union Gospel Tabernacle to the Ryman Auditorium. The response was a unanimous yay. 40 years later, the Grand Ole Opry radio show moved into the Ryman. From 1943 until 1974, the Ryman Auditorium was synonymous with country music. In 1993, Gaylord Entertainment began an $8 million renovation of the Ryman, and today, it's a favorite venue for concerts. For many years, a popular gospel music series was entitled appropriately, Sam's Place.
There's something in that building, and I really think that it's because of the great preaching of men like Sam Jones, and thinking of the people that were so convicted by the message and bowing their head on that pew and giving their life to Christ. If those pews could speak and tell stories, you know, just think of what it could tell. I don't really think that Nashville, Tennessee would be the city that it is, known for music, known for publishing, Thomas Nelson. I mean, so many of the denomination's headquarters is right here in Nashville. I just don't think that would have been here had there not been a major revival, you know, in the 1800s. To me, it's the chief cornerstone of this city. I think it's the most important building in Nashville.
What an incredible history. And that's a story you probably won't see anywhere else, but it's incredible, the history and the good news history behind one of the major landmarks in America.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. I didn't know anything about that. That was really a great story. Well, coming up, a child facing surgery got a huge surprise.
Well, we prayed. And he kind of looked at me and said, well, you sure did something, because I've not ever seen eardrums this bright and pink in anything but an infant.
Find out why this boy's operation was canceled when we come back.
John Mapes is 42,
yeah.
Mortgage, married, two great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? 60? 40? Actually, none of the above. John can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $25 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll search the pick of insurers like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. John's wife, Carrie, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or visit SelectQuote.com.
Call 1-800-499-5158.
Ear infections are fairly common in young children, but Colin Stoddard's infections were so severe, his eardrums completely deteriorated. By the time he was only 8, Colin was facing surgery to repair the damage, until his doctor saw something that caused him to cancel the operation.
From the time Colin Stoddard was a toddler, the piano drew him like a magnet. His parents saw his fascination and enrolled him in piano lessons at age 5.
With Colin, he especially had fun with the piano more than most other children. He liked to get even underneath the piano and put his arms up around above the keyboard, and he would play backwards.
But as Colin developed a passion for music, major complications with his ears also developed. A series of severe colds and ear infections left doctors predicting that he would eventually be hearing impaired.
Those colds kind of started when he was around 6 months of age. But then when he would get a cold that was so bad that he would wake up at nighttime crying and there would be blood on his pillow, then I knew that the eardrums had ruptured.
Doctors decided to place tubes in Colin's ears to release the pressure in his ear canals. However, the tubes had a destructive effect on the ears.
The tube will fall out on its own or will be taken out, and when that occurs, the tympanic membrane usually heals up on its own. There are a few cases that you get a hole that fails to heal.
The tubes had caused his eardrums to deteriorate completely.
I had personally looked through a giant otoscope and seen little tiny scar tissue that was lining an ear canal, and it was discolored and looked dead and was totally rolled back. So I know enough to know that without an eardrum there, he shouldn't be able to hear. What we were seeing with Colin, though, is that Colin could hear. His speech was developing way beyond what would normally be expected. He was incredibly articulate as a 2- and a 3-year-old.
Despite Colin's ability to hear, serious complications with his ears still remained. His inner ears were dangerously exposed, and Colin needed to undergo a skin graft surgery that would provide long-term protection. 8-year-old Colin became terrified at the possibility of surgery, so Colin and his mother did something in addition to consulting with the doctors.
It was comforting, I think, to Colin as a 7 to 8 year old, though, when we were planning the surgeries, to say, God is going to heal your ears, Colin. And that those words brought me comfort as I'm speaking them to my own son.
Colin had one final doctor's visit to plan the surgery.
He sat me down on the table and said, all right, I'm just gonna look in your ears one more time to make sure that we're good to go. And as he was looking in my ears, he got really quiet and just kept changing the magnification on his otoscope. And I remember them saying, oh, what's wrong? You know, what's the problem here? And he said, well, I don't understand what happened, but Colin has eardrums all of a sudden. He's got brand new eardrums, and I've not ever seen eardrums this bright and pink in anything but an infant.
And my whole stomach just kind of rose up into my throat, and I couldn't talk at all. And I remember kind of backing up against the wall, thinking I need to hang onto the wall because I was so surprised.
And me stating the obvious as a, you know, 7-year-old laying on the table, I go, oh, well, we prayed. And he kind of looked at me and said, well, you sure did something because Colin has brand new eardrums.
And I looked in and it was beautiful. It was so beautiful. It was pink. It was alive. There was life where there was death in his ears.
What may be unusual in this case was that he hadn't healed at all. And then within 1 week, 2 office visits, he seemed to heal. So that does sound unusual.
Colin went on to excel as a pianist and eventually earned a music degree from Belmont University in Nashville, Tennessee. Today, Colin travels the country singing and playing the piano as a part of the Christian trio, 33 Miles.
And it's been amazing to see how the Lord took just a little idea as a 5-year-old of my parents saying, we need to, you know, Colin needs to have piano lessons. And the world would say, well, he doesn't have eardrums, he can hardly listen. And they say, well, it's okay, well, the Lord has a plan. It's just simply about me continuing in the music that I felt like the Lord has wanted me to have ever since just being a little child.
The key message, the Lord has a plan. It doesn't matter what your situation, what your circumstances, what your need, the Lord has a plan. We need to tap into that. We want to take some time to pray for you and for your needs, but that is a faith-building story, isn't it?
What an incredible story. Yeah. I mean, from one office visit to another.
Within a week.
Eardrums go back and it just leaves the doctor speechless. Well, here's one that'll leave you speechless. This is Rhonda of Portsmouth, Ohio. Last February, she began to experience unexplained body movements. By May, she was having full-blown seizures. Doctor asked for an MRI, showed lesions on her brain. And he had no explanation for why the lesions were causing convulsions. By September, she was having spasms almost constantly and was confined to her bed. On September 8th, she was watching the previous day's 700 Club broadcast. I guess she had recorded it. And Terry, you had a word of knowledge. Someone else with seizures, unexplained seizures. That is stopping. It will not happen again in Jesus' name. Then I had a word of knowledge. There are lesions on your brain. God has just healed every single lesion. You are healed. You are set free. Well, Rhonda said, it's me. It's me. Yeah. She got out of bed, walked around the house. The convulsions stopped at that moment and haven't returned. Wow. A few days later, she went back to the doctor, had another MRI. No lesions at all on the brain. And that is a miracle.
Boy, I guess that. So. Praise God. That's awesome. Well, here's one. For 30 years, Estella, who's from San Antonio, Texas, lived in pain from curvature of the spine, and she had a protruding disc as well. This also then caused pain in her right knee. So last August, she was watching television. She heard a voice prompting her to turn on the 700 Club. She heard this voice repeat, turn on the 700 Club 2 more times. Now, she was familiar with this program, but she hadn't watched it much and didn't know what time it came on or even what channel. So she started flipping through the channels and came across you, Gordon, receiving a word of knowledge that God was healing a spine and removing the pain that it was bringing to the right hip. She claimed the word. The pain she had endured for years was gone instantly. Since then, no more discomfort in her back, hip, Orny.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I just sense faith is rising. Right now, you've heard these reports. You saw the report. God, able to grow back eardrums. God, able to heal lesions on the brain. God, able to stop convulsions. God, able to hear a spine, a 30-year condition. She heard a voice, turn on the TV, turn on the TV. Right now, just believe God. What he's done for others, he will do for you. He is no respecter of persons. All that's required is that we believe. If you believe that you have already received, then you'll have it. These aren't my words. These are the words of Jesus Christ. You can find them in Mark 11, verse 24. Believe that you've already received, and you'll have it. So right now, in an act of faith, lay your hand on that area of the body that needs healing. And let's just believe God. Let's trust him, his unfailing love, his mercy. He's coming to you right now, bringing healing to you. Now, in the name of Jesus, let's pray. Lord, we just come into agreement with those who are praying. And as they lay hands on that area of the body that needs healing, we just join with them and we say out loud, be healed, be made whole in the name of Jesus. There's a woman, you're laying your right hand on your right hip and that pain just left. As soon as you heard the word hip, your pain is gone now. In Jesus' name. Someone else laying hands on your right shoulder. You're having trouble even reaching the area that's got the most pain in the back, on the ribs. And God is healing that for you right now from the shoulder all the way down that right side. You're healed. You're made whole. That injury no longer will affect you and inhibit you in any way. In Jesus' name, you're healed. Terry.
Someone else, you've had some kind of a strange rupture in your female organs. I don't even understand what that is, but it's a crisis situation. God is healing that for you, and that bleeding's just going to stop. There's going to be just a creative miracle done in repairing that. Just receive that now. Let that fear go out from you that's been in you. God is doing something that you can't even imagine. Someone else, you have a problem with like the your brainstem at the top where it goes, where your spine connects with your brainstem, and God is just ironing that out for you right now. You've had problems with impulses and movement and just loss of feeling. God's healing all of that for you.
Someone, you're crying out for Tourette's syndrome, and the doctors say it's incurable, but with God, all things are possible. And so the one you're praying for right now being healed, someone else with a blockage in your intestine caused by surgery, they nicked one of your intestines, you're being healed right now. That's being released now. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report. So call us 1-800-759-0700. We leave you these words from Isaiah, peace, peace to those far and near, says the Lord, and I will heal them.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. From Thailand to South Africa, from Ukraine to India, and many places in between, I've had the privilege of seeing the incredible work CBN partners are accomplishing. You've brought help and hope to so many people and changed their lives forever. Just like you did for Hannah. This 15-year-old was forced to leave home because her parents could no longer afford to feed her. While working as a maid, she saw a CBN program and received Jesus as her Savior. Now her life is filled with joy and hope. Each month, your gift makes it possible to feed the hungry, help disaster victims, heal the sick, and broadcast the gospel. So please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. Thank you for joining with us. And here's something wonderful I hope you'll remember. Somewhere in this world, someone is thanking God because you were there.